The UK's Prime Minister is fighting for his political future as the country heads into an election year. Rishi Sunak made 5 pledges to improve life for the British people. So, how's he doing on those? Hello and welcome to Roundtable. I'm Enda Brady. Rishi Sunak came to power after tumultuous leadership stints by Boris Johnson and Liz Truss. Remember her? He promised to be a serious and reliable politician. But has he delivered?
In 2022, Rishi Sunak asked the public to give him until the end of 2023 to tackle the big issues. This is his assessment.
Inflation is set to fall further, cutting the cost of living for everyone. And we're not stopping there. We're going further to grow our economy by reducing debt, cutting taxes and rewarding hard work.
Inflation has indeed come down significantly. The rate at which prices increase hit a 10.7% high, but fell to 3.9% in November. This was largely due to a decrease in energy prices. Growth in 2023 was largely flat, which is unusual. Normally, a developed economy will grow. But rising interest rates to tackle inflation put on the brakes. The UK's debt level was 1.8% higher in November 2023 than it was a year earlier. Rishi Sunak also pledged to bring down wait times in the National Health Service. In England, the overall number of outstanding appointments was 7.7 million in October, 500,000 higher than at the start of the year.
We're taking decisive action to stop the boats and break the business model of the criminal gangs.
In 2023, over 29,000 people crossed the English Channel to enter the UK. This is down from a 2022 high of nearly 46,000, but the boats have not stopped. All in all, the Prime Minister has fallen short of delivering on what he set out to do. So, are British voters keeping score?
Well, let's meet our guests. Claire Pearsall is a former special advisor at the UK's Home Office. She's currently Chief of Staff to the Conservative Member of Parliament, Caroline Noakes. John McTernan is the former political secretary to British Prime Minister Tony Blair. He's now a political strategist for BCW, that's a global communications agency. And Norman Baker is a former Liberal Democrat Home Office Minister. Norman served under David Cameron's coalition government from 2010 to 2015. John, I'll come to you first of all. Was this a mistake by Rishi Sunak, setting out these 5 things, ambitions, that the UK public could judge him on?
Yep, absolutely. They say you only have one chance to make a first impression. The chance was when he took over from Liz Truss. So you don't say who you are and what you're going to do months after. You do it immediately. You go, I'm a break from the past, I'm doing this. That's the first reason it's a mistake. The second reason is, He set tests he was going to fail, and he's failed them on the NHS. Top of people's concerns in the country. On the NHS, there's going to be more than 8 million people waiting, so failed on that. On cost of living, took a target about inflation, which the government doesn't control, met it, but does anybody in Britain feel they're doing better off in terms of cost of living? So don't set tests you can't meet, and do say who you're going to be the minute you become the new Prime Minister, not a few months afterwards.
Claire, he's made a rod for his own back, hasn't he?
I think he has. And the problem is that the original 5 pledges that he stood outside Downing Street and gave to the country have changed somewhat. We've had a new set of 5 promises. So the wording has changed. The character of them has changed. And it just leads you to believe that he doesn't quite know what it is he wants to be. He doesn't know how to be. And I think that is the major problem. People don't understand entirely what Rishi Sunak stands for, what his political strategy is, and what his vision is for the country. And I think that's a real problem when you're looking at a general election in not very many months' time.
Norman, what was your take on the pledges? I mean, did he get it wrong from the outset?
Well, yes. If you go back to the press coverage of the pledges which were announced by the Prime Minister, the response from the press and from experts at the time was, this is not what the paper's written on because they're so easy to meet. He's going to meet all these pledges and that'll prove nothing. Well, of course, they haven't been easy to meet at all. The only one that's been met is the inflation one, which is not actually him. It's a Bank of England and their fiscal control that's brought that inflation down. And he's changed, as Claire says, he's changed the wording. It was stop the boats, now it's introduced laws to stop the boats, which is a different matter altogether. Then you got to consider whether or not the five pledges were the correct pledges. I mean,
yes.
Nothing about social care, nothing about housing and the problem we've got, nothing about net zero and climate change. So he picked these five pledges almost out of a hat, thinking he was going to tick every box and say to the country, well, I've achieved all this.
Well,
and it's all backfired terribly.
John?
To think through what he was thinking about, it wasn't necessarily about achieving them. It was about saying, I'm the change, I'm not Liz Truss. I'm making differences to the country, moving on various things. And the idea was, I've made sufficient progress to go to the country and go, I'm making progress, don't risk it with Keir. And the problem is, he's not made sufficient progress. And he's also found it very difficult to make Keir Starmer a risk, because the Tory critique of Keir is two things. One is he's boring, another one is he's a risk. Well, you're one or the other. If you're boring, you're not a risk. You're boring, but you're not a risk. And so risks are... So I think that's the difficulty. The strategy was clearly, I've started, let me finish. The kind of mastermind strategy.
And that's right. And it works when you're in a position when the country's economy is doing well, when the NHS isn't broken, and you've got things that are working in your favour. You can go out there and you can put those targets that are easily met, like with inflation, which isn't in his gift whatsoever. But people would say, oh, that's great. He's done a good job. But unfortunately, when you are in the kind of trouble that the country is in currently, all it's going to look like is that he doesn't entirely know what he's doing.
This Conservative obsession with stopping the boats.
Yeah.
Distilling, you know, very complex situations down into three-word slogans. It doesn't work, does it?
It's Dominic Cummings' idea, you're having three-word slogans for everything, but stopping the boats, you can't stop the boats, you can't start the planes. I mean, it's completely a fail in that policy. And, of course, the idea that you declare people who come in by unorthodox means illegal is simply not right in international law. Someone can claim asylum and then they're judged on the facts. And the method they use to get to the country is not a relevant factor as to whether they are genuine asylum seekers or not.
Does the public care, the British public? You know, when you talk to people on the street, they're primarily concerned about cost of living, interest rates, mortgages, health service.
So, the top people's concerns are cost of living, health service, crime. And if I was running a Labour campaign, I'd be saying, on the doorstep, ask a question, simple question. Do you feel better off today than you did 5 years ago? Do you think your local hospital, your local GP, is better than it was five? Simple questions that connect. And I think that goes to, I think, Claire's point. You don't feel that Rishi Sunak as Prime Minister emotionally connects with what life is like in Britain. It's always hard to be Prime Minister. You're isolated. It's always hard to be a rich Prime Minister, personally rich and familiarly rich. But you've got to make a connection. And for all his flaws, Boris Johnson felt like he had a connection to the public. And if you can be undone by a simple question, how do you feel? If we go around the country saying, how do you feel? No one's going to go, do you know what? I want to give that guy another chance because I'm feeling better. People aren't even feeling hopeful. They just want change. And I think that was the big slip this year, this last year. Rishi Sunak said, the country needs change. And the voters are going, you're right. but the change is, we don't want you. And I think that's difficult in an election campaign. When you let the change thing, you surface that. When it's change, you need a change.
Claire, what are you hearing inside Conservative halls of power?
People are frustrated. People are angry. People are fundamentally depressed. Those are the emotions that are going around within Westminster and also within activists outside of Westminster who are the ones who are out there to sell the message to their constituents. It's really difficult when you have something given to you as this is the Conservative policy, which is then changed, U-turned, dropped, call it what you will. It leaves you in that position of being run up a hill once, maybe twice, and you wonder why on earth you're doing it again. And I think MPs themselves are feeling under fire, not only from their constituents, from their activists, but every other member of...
From their partners, even.
Absolutely, from their partners, from their families, but also people around the country who get in touch. Just because they're an MP for a constituency doesn't stop people getting in touch. And they do. And opinions are very valid, whether they come from Scotland, whether they come from Cornwall, over in Ipswich, wherever it may be. People are saying, we're fed up, what is your message? Why aren't you doing anything about education? Why aren't you doing anything about housing, which is what Norman was saying? And they want that hope, and I think that's what John said. If you can't get that message out of hope, you really are on a losing wicket.
He's not really giving the public anything to hope for in 2024, though,
is he? Well, he's not. He's not, and he's doubling down, actually, because he said that he wants to have the election towards the end of the year. And he's hoping, presumably, that some of these strategies he's got will somehow bear fruit. Well, I'm sorry to say that when a government's in trouble, going towards the end of a time and stringing out for 5 years just annoys the public even more.
Yeah.
We saw it with John Major, we saw it with Gordon Brown. It doesn't work. And the best thing you can do, frankly, is cut his losses and go to the country early. Jim Callaghan's another case who went on far too long. And the public are just saying, we want an election now, why are you hanging on?
Yeah.
And it's not doing yourself any good. And none of these things are going to improve in the next 6 months. I mean, the economy won't suddenly change. The NHS waiting list was 7.2 million when he made that pledge, down 7.7 million. It's got much worse.
Heading for eight.
Nothing's going to improve. He was not going to stop these boats. They're going to carry on. In fact, they get worse in the summer. So, in fact, delaying matters will make it worse because that's when the key passages of boats coming across, when the weather's good in the summer. So that's going to get worse as well. And, you know, I don't mind him being rich, coming back to the point about his wealth. No. You know, I don't mind Prime Ministers being rich or not being
rich. Can he be in touch with the public if he's married to a billionaire?
He can be, and I remember Nick Brown, the Labour agriculture spokesman, was a very, very good agriculture minister. He represented Newcastle upon Tyne. He was brilliant at that job. So you don't have to be rich, you don't have to be poor to understand the poor. But if you go around taking helicopters all over the place and private jets, you're never on a train or on a bus. What does that message give you? There was a great cartoon the other day in one of the papers, and it was Rishi Sunak talking to someone on a bus, and the cartoon coming out of his mouth was saying to this woman on the bus, and what heliport do you use? That's kind of how he comes across.
John, last time you were on Roundtable, you asked the question, who is Rishi Sunak? Are we any nearer, after all these pledges, to understanding who he is?
I don't think we are, because the pledges were followed by all these changes of character. Tech bro, a break with the past, the failed past, including David Cameron's government, then the man who appoints David Cameron, then the man who actually wants the Rwanda deal. In politics, you can't always be popular. You can't always be popular with the voters or your own party. You need to know what your driving core is, like Norman mentioned Gordon Brown. No one ever doubted Gordon Brown's commitment to social justice. People knew what he was in politics for. There's a feeling now about Rishi Sunak, which is, are you somebody who wants to have been prime minister? Is it just like a trophy you want to have had in your cabinet? And if you're rich, very few rich people are ever prime minister. So maybe that makes you have status on the West Coast when you go to America. You've been prime minister of the UK. That's the thing. Nobody else can. You can't buy it. You just wonder what's the driving force? I'm sure you don't become an MP, you don't become a minister or prime minister without having a core of political belief. I just can't discern it. And I want to be empathetic to somebody. I've been in the pressure of number 10. It's really difficult. But the leaders who are great, you kind of know, Margaret Thatcher, Tony Blair, any situation, you know what they decide without asking them. You just describe a situation, they do this, they do that. Rishi Sunak, I don't know what he'd decide.
Who is he? What does he stand for?
It's really difficult to pin down. And as John said, you need somebody that has an automatic recognition when you mention their name. And you get that with Tony Blair, you get that with Margaret Thatcher, and to a degree with David Cameron, who was a very similar person. Gordon Brown, I think, was handed a really poison chalice. And it was very, very difficult. But I think that Rishi Sunak, although he has made some kind of stratospheric leap from a very junior minister into chancellor and then into prime minister, I don't feel that he's very politically aware. I think he's really actually politically naive. He doesn't understand the internal workings of his own parliamentary party, the workings of Whitehall, and how to go about it. And yes, John is right. You can't always be popular when you're a prime minister. You have to make some really horrible decisions. People will hate you 50% of the time, but you have to go out there and you have to do it. Theresa May was one of those individuals, whether you loved her or loathed her, who had service at the very heart of her premiership. She is now sitting on the back benches as an MP after being the most important person within the country. Yeah, I can't see Rishi Sunak doing that should he ever leave this job.
So, Norman, do you think he just bails and he goes to California?
Well, they generally bail out, don't they? I mean, if you think about the prime ministers who carried on, John Major carried on for a term. as a backbencher. Theresa May carried on. A lot of time for Theresa, as a matter of fact. Who else carried on? Blair went right away, didn't he? Gordon Brown carried on, actually, for another term. Ted Heath carried on. Well, for different reasons, actually, yeah. In Ted Heath's case. Exactly. But you know, I think that's exactly right. And if you bail out right away and say, well, I've had my toys taken away, so I'm leaving you and causing a by-election, that doesn't look very good, in my view.
So what should he do? If you were advising him now, an election possibly as early as April or May?
Well, it's February. A bit late. I mean, he's unlikely to have asked me what to do, but if he had asked me what to do, I would have said way back when, it's a bit like John said earlier on, say what you stand for, plant your flag and sell it.
Yeah.
Sell what you believe in so you can inspire people. And actually, I find in politics, if you say what you believe in and you try and sell it, even people who don't agree with you will still vote for you because they think you've got integrity.
Authenticity.
Authenticity. And actually, he hasn't done that, and he needs to do that. But it's too late now, almost. What he needs to do now is to say, look, all these mistakes have been made. It hasn't been a very successful time. I think we can correct it. Here's my agenda for the future, and I'm going to the country on that agenda. I mean, it's not a great sales pitch, but that's the best you can do at the moment.
It's never too, in my view, it's never too late in politics.
Yeah.
In the sense that the great thing about John Major, he won the election. He was 7 years as Prime Minister. He started the Northern Ireland peace process properly. But towards the end of his... He could see they were going to lose. He was a steward of the nation.
Yes,
he made
right.
decisions in the national interest.
He cared.
He cared about handing over a great country to the future.
And he still cares.
And not fearing that the opposition coming into power would destroy the country. And I think trusting the nation, trusting the country, trust the voters. The voters never get it wrong. Whenever they make a decision, they don't get it wrong. So if I was advising Rishi Sunak now, I'd say, let's just start. Let's have a year in which we make decisions in the national interest. So when people look back, they go, you didn't have a fire sale. You didn't do this, didn't do that. What you did was you thought hard about the right thing, made a conservative decision, a conservative politician, conservative government, and that was built on or altered, but you made the right decision for the country. And I think the difficulties at the moment, it feels it's always like, what's Tory party interest? What do my backbenchers want? Yeah.
Is that the problem, Claire, with the public, that a lot of people see Rishi Sunak, the cabinet, this Conservative government in particular, that it's about keeping power and it's not really about making people's lives any better?
Yeah, I think people view it as self-interest and that's what's governing the country, sadly. And I think that Rishi Sunak is now in a really difficult position because it would be nice if you could, say, have a year and put out your priorities straight. Yeah, yeah. But unfortunately, the Conservative Party currently is so fractured that it's just not going to let that happen. And it feels like they are on that road to destruction. And it doesn't matter who is in charge. You could have Rishi Sunak, you could have a Kemi Badenoch, you could have someone else. It would be the same. The Conservative Party itself is now a problem and you aren't going to change that just by changing
it. Is it a toxic brand?
It's just a toxic brand. The Nazi Party is back, to use Theresa May's phrase. But I would say to Rishi Sunak, he's going to lose. But if he goes in May, he'll lose less badly than if he goes in October. The longer it goes on, the worse the result will be. Worse.
There's a couple of names I want to chuck into the conversation. Nigel Farage and Richard Tice. Reform UK Party. Can they really damage the Conservatives by putting up candidates and Farage gets back involved in frontline politics again?
Look, I think it's a great question. And yes, they can, but they can only damage the Conservative Party because the Conservative Party is weak. There's something about governments, and I think, Norman, you said it, there's a moment when you start to fail and everybody inside knows it. Your friends at number 10 know. People know it. And you just, once you start making mistakes, you make more mistakes. And when you get weak, you get weaker and weaker. And that's what Farage smells, the weakness. That's why he's doing this dance for the public, dance for the journalists. Am I going to stand? Why am I going to leave? What are we going to do? And the point is, they want to pick off the Tory party, pick off Tory voters, pick off Tory MPs. It's all about the splintering of the right. Farage and Tice don't benefit immediately in an election, they benefit from the collapse of the Tory party. And my view about politics is you do need to have a strong opposition. If you're a government, we need a stronger opposition at times than we got from the Tory party. It keeps you honest as a party if the Labour Party has a strong opposition. And the Tory party have benefited from a weak Labour Party, but it's not helped them. They need to So the Tory party as a weak party is bad for British politics. Farage is just, they're looking at it as if they can pick it off. They're vultures. But Farage is a great TV property.
Yeah, absolutely. They are disruptors. Yeah. And I've spoken to both individuals over the last 12 months, and that is what they're there to do. Yeah. They are there to disrupt politics. They are there to take down a government.
Yes.
And I don't think it would necessarily matter what government
that's true.
That's what they want to achieve. And John's right, this dance with Nigel Farage, will he stand, will he not, keeps everybody interested. It keeps people who are fed up with the Conservative Party, keeps them interested in what could be round the corner, but it doesn't mean that he is going to stand. And I for one, don't think he will. I think he will keep out
of it. His worst nightmare is winning.
Absolutely his worst nightmare is
winning.
Imagine
being an MP.
Then he is responsible and then he is accountable to the public, and he doesn't need that and he doesn't want it.
He's a character that could do untold damage, though, isn't he? I mean, he's media gold dust.
Well, if they carry out what they've said, which is not to withdraw any candidates and to stand in every single seat, which is, they said that before and changed their minds in 2019, but if they carry that through this time, it would be very damaging to the Conservative Party, because my estimate is 3/4 of the Reform vote will come from the Conservatives, maybe a quarter from Lib Dems and Labour, but most of it will come from the Conservatives. You then add in the fact that the SNP are collapsing north of the border, which is going to benefit the Labour Party. You then look at the fact that across the country in England, people are working out how to defeat the Tories in their particular seat. So if they're in one seat, they're going to vote Labour, another seat, they're going to vote Lib Dem. They don't really care who they're voting for. They just want the Tories out. So that's a hugely difficult scenario for the Conservatives, because in every which way they look, they're going to be hammered.
John, going back to Labour...
Yeah.
Keir Starmer must be sitting back, rubbing his hands with glee.
So, I don't think he is. His speech about his New Year speech really said the country's in a terrible situation. And anybody who believes in Britain doesn't like a situation where the country's in the state it's in and where the public don't believe things can get better. That's a big danger. And I think Keir is also still looking at himself and going, how have I done so well so quickly? Because Labour in 1983 got its worst defeats in the 30s. It took us till 1997 to recover. In 2019, we've got our next worst result, and we're 5 years on, 4 years on from that, and Labour looked like it could win an election.
With a landslide.
With a landslide. And it's like going from 96, just before the election, we've done that, and in 2 years, because the pandemic wasn't really politics, was it? I think he's kind of head spinning a bit. So I don't think Keir's celebrating. He's being overcautious at times about policy promises and what the difference the country will be like. But I also think he should be proud of the achievement, because this government fell apart under its own steam, but also partly by opposition probing. So Keir's done an amazing job. His task this year is to set out, I am the change. What's the change I'll be for you? At the moment, it is country needs change. But the country needs to know what that change might be.
Claire, when will Sunak go to the polls then? Call it.
Yeah. Well, if you read the news today on social media, it will be the second half of this year. He has ruled out anything earlier than that, which I think we can all take with a massive pinch of salt.
Yes.
And I still hold hard to May being the date for an election.
So you think he'll go in May?
I do. I don't see the benefit to going longer because, yes, the economy may pick up, but also, as Norman has said, the boats during the summer will keep on coming and people will still come and arrive. So I think that if you are going to have a set of local elections, which we are, and mayoral elections on the 4th of May... Why would you let that disaster come ahead of another election?
Yep.
I think you have to wrap it all up into
just
one.
Just swallow the pill?
Is that
what you do, Norman?
Well, I mean, I think given the circumstances which exist, yes, I would go early rather than go later. That's what he needs to do, but I don't think he will. I think the evidence from history is he'll hang on and hope something will turn up.
And that's not really a great kind of lesson from history, is it? Because I don't think anything...
No,
it's 20 percentage
points
behind.
It never works, but don't underestimate the fact that another 6 months in office is quite attractive.
What, for just for him, for his CV?
Yeah, just to be there.
Yeah, but look, there's that saying, isn't there? The light at the end of the tunnel, it may turn out to be an express train. And I think that's actually what's coming for the Tories. It's just like, boom. and they can run, but they can't hide.
Claire, hand on heart, are you really looking at a Labour landslide and Conservative Party being obliterated for possibly a decade?
I would like to hope not. I really... I've been a Conservative member for such a long time that it pains me to see the party in this state. I do think that we're going to lose. The party will hate me further for saying it, but I do. I think that it may not be the landslide of 97. I don't think that the opposition are in as strong a position as they were back in 96, looking like a government coming forward. I think that people will see them as an alternative to the Conservative Party because they don't like them, but it's not necessarily for anything that Labour are offering. Yes, no, yes is the kind of long-winded answer to this. Yes, I think the Conservative Party are going to be out of power, but it may not be for very long if they can get their act together and pull together and see what they want.
Well, can they? Because, I mean, I'm not quite sure what shape the Conservative Party will be in after the next election. Are we going to see them drift further to the right to deal with Nigel Farage?
I do think that depends on who you have left after an election. That's always really important as to which side or which particular wing of the party you have left, as to how you rebuild and who becomes your leader and what you become once more. So it's a very, very difficult... You know, you can look at the polls, you can look at all the predictions and see who you think you have left, but until those votes are cast, you don't know for sure.
After most defeats... Parties in opposition go. They first blame the voters, then they blame each other.
Yeah.
And it becomes really hard to recover in one cycle.
Yeah.
And that's, there's only been one-term government in Britain since the Second World War.
John, the clock has beaten us. Thank you all for your insights. 2024 will deliver a result one way or the other. Remember, you can see more discussion and debate on our YouTube channel. Search for Roundtable TRT World. But for now, from me and the Brady and all of the team here, goodbye and thank you for watching.